Our next speaker is Kenichi Sasaki, another graduate from the anthropology department here at Harvard, as well as having received a bachelor's degree from the University of Michigan. His research interests are in state formation processes in peripheral regions of Japan and the archaeology of regional interaction. He is also dedicated to introducing Japanese archaeology to the West and American archaeology to Japan. And he's been working quite a bit lately on a history of American archaeology in Japanese. He recently published a 700-page site report on excavations of a very interesting group of cairns and earthen mounds in the central highlands of Japan. And today, he's going to talk to us about the issues of recent controversies.
Okay. First of all, I'd like to thank Professor Flood, Professor Perry, for bringing me back to Harvard. Recently, I have been involved in university administration so much. Last year, as the chairman of the international committee of the faculty, I returned to North America 4 times, but none to Cambridge, Massachusetts. So it's my great, great pleasure to be here. Today, I'll be speaking. At first, when I received an email that invitation for participation in roundtable, Asian archaeology, recent discoveries and controversies. I thought that I could talk about recent discoveries and controversies related to my own specialty, state formation processes in Japan. And then a few weeks later, I received a guideline saying, controversies in archaeology that may reflect tensions in contemporary society, political, social, and religious class, or otherwise. I was a little bit surprised. And yes, I was. And I really thought about it very, very hard. And instead, other presenters have presented their talks in very logical manner. Instead, I just highlight what kind of controversies in Japanese archaeology that reflect really tensions in contemporary society. First of all, because I am interested in state formation processes, one thing that I cannot stay away from is issues related to imperial mausoleum in Japan. In Japan, we have large number of keyhole-shaped mounded tombs. Some of them are very large, like the length exceeds 300 meters. And the largest ones of each chronological phase are all designated as an imperial mausoleum. And imperial mausoleum is not designated as a historic site, but as considered as a the private property of the imperial house in Japan still exists. And because it is sacred, it's a private property, we cannot, no excavation. We cannot actually get into burial mounds at all, nor can we survey. And occasionally, curatorial staff of the imperial household agencies conduct excavations, putting trenches prior to the restoration of mound that has been eroded, something. The funny thing is that, first of all, this particular slide located in northern Osaka Prefecture is scholarly considered as the tomb of Emperor Keitai, who reigned in the first quarter of the 6th century. But local government could excavate this site for 10 years, fully excavated this site. The reason is that the national government erroneously designated a larger keyhole-shaped mounted tomb as Emperor Keitai's mausoleum. But it is dated to the middle 5th century. The national government doesn't like to admit this error. Well, error occurred because there was a mix-up of place names during the Tokugawa period. So the national government of Japan in the late 19th century designated a different tomb as Emperor Keita's mausoleum based on wrong place name during the Tokugawa period. And this keyhole-shaped mounted tomb happened to be larger than this. This tomb happened to be 192 meters in length. And owing to 10-year-long excavations, it's more or less restored. It is keyhole-shaped, I mean, enclosed by two moats. And on the dike of a moat, numerous Hanyuwa ceramic figurines, modeling houses, modeling fences, all sorts of things. And this gives you an idea of what the tomb of the highest ranking chief in each chronological phase of the Kofun period looked like. Thanks to the erroneous designation of the imperial mausoleum. And also, funny thing is that we also have imperial mausoleum of nine mythical emperors. First nine emperors are considered non-existent, purely mythical, but we do have mausoleum for these nine tombs, and I mean mausoleum for these nine emperors. And the existence was already, recognized that when Japan built the first permanent capital in 694, these nine tombs were already maintained without being destroyed prior to the construction of capital. So it persists that this has persisted for a long, long time since the end of the 7th century until the present. Related to the state formation process, another controversy that reflects contemporary society is the dominance of Marxist perspectives of Japanese archaeology and history until very recently, until the early 1990s. And the Marxist perspectives were considered, considered useful, probably, especially after Japan's loss of the Second World War, because, Japan participated in the Second World War under the name of the Emperor Hirohito, and because of the stratified society, Japan did all sorts of bad things in Korea and China, and social stratification, Marxist perspectives were considered very useful. And some archaeologists and historians really, really maintained close ties with Japan Communist Party until recently. These people are very old and most of them died, but a few remaining scholars still maintain very close ties with Japan Communist Party. Nothing political, but they are good friends with Japan Communist Party, and if you visit these houses of these famous historians, archaeologists, they still read the organ of Japan Communist Party, Red Flag. Really, really surprising, but that is truth. And really, so theoreticians, active theoreticians in Japanese archaeology are all Marxist until the early 1990s. Another issue that related to the contemporary society would be archaeological issues related to contemporary societies, issues related to the Ainu people, the indigenous people in Hokkaido, northern island of Japan. And definition of Ainu people, that's really, to some extent political and to a large extent historical, based on interaction between the mainland Japan and northern island Japan throughout the past two millennia. And in the Jomon period, that is to say, Jomon period started around like 15,000 years ago and lasted until 7th, maybe 8th century BCE, and characterized by sedentary hunting-gathering economy. And the Jomon period, okay, the Jomon culture existed not only the mainland Japan, but also the northern island Japan, Hokkaido. This is purely based on pottery typology. I mean, they are basically the product of the same level of technology. That's fine. Archaeologically, that's fine. What a little bit scares me is that this is utilized, this evidence is used by right-wing activists as the evidence of a long, continuous, unbroken Japanese history from the Jomon period and up to the present. And for around 7th century, when we adopted wet rice cultivation, these cultures came from Korea, and right-wing activists wanted to ignore this evidence. Anyway, and another thing related to this right-wing activists' argument, for example, Jomon pottery is very old, one of the oldest in the world. This Jomon pottery in the collection of Meiji University, and this is dated to the second phase of the Jomon period, still 9,600 BP, and excavated in an American naval base. And says, another thing is that this is an axe in the late Paleolithic period, dated to 35,000 years ago. And the thing is that axes in the late Paleolithic period in Japan have these polished edges. Edges are polished. And so, like, polished stone tools are a symbol of Neolithic period. The thing is that in Japan, we have axes, chipped stone axes with polished edges in the late Paleolithic context. And together with the oldness of Jomon pottery, right-wing activists want to use this as the evidence for superiority of Japanese people. And there was even attempt to write a textbook based on these lines of evidence. Very fortunately, this attempt failed. The thing is that many congressmen in Japan of the National Diet really are very much in favor of this argument. I am really, really scared because the logic is somewhat similar to what Natchez did. Oh, okay. But I used that all the time. But thank you very much for listening.